Good morning and welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church of Ferndale. This is our online service during the midst of this pandemic, and we're grateful that you've tuned in to worship with us on this Sunday morning. These are unusual times, and we're doing our best to make the best of them, and so we appreciate your cooperation and your love for each other that you're showing in many ways. I was thinking this morning that in 2022, we will be celebrating the 100th anniversary of this congregation. I was imagining the stories we might tell and who will be there to tell those stories. And so as we look forward to that and to being together again in better times, I'm reminded of the past, the good times, the changes, and the times that we've been through together before. And so this too will pass, and now we can celebrate the great history of this church in the next couple of years, but also look forward to continuing to minister in the name and the Spirit of Christ here in this community. Without any further patting ourselves on the back or anything like that, let's go into worship. It's time now to turn our attention to God. Welcome. We'll begin by singing the hymn that describes much of what the church is about. Many gifts, one Spirit. It's in the United Methodist hymnal at 114.
Thank you.
today, would you pray with me? God, who is present in pain and in joy, we bring our fears and concerns to you today, as well as our hopes and our gratitude for moments of joy and strength in the midst of uncertainty. Contagion is much on our minds these days, and our lives seem to be filled with precautions and distances and questions. Yet there's another kind of contagion that is easily forgotten when our living seems to be so boxed in. Today, remind us again of the contagion of the early church, where there was so much love and generosity and goodness poured out on humanity that people were infected by the overwhelming graciousness of these first Christians. Even in our isolation, can we too be so filled with you that our words and lives draw others to come into contact with the peace and the power that can be found in you? Grant us glimpses of your glory and goodness so we can reflect you. Amen. Good morning, kids. It's good to have a chance to talk to you again this morning. I wish we were able to be here together, but that's a little ways down the road yet. But I'm glad to be talking to you anyway. And I was wondering, maybe you can email me or send me a video or something. Tell me, what are you doing to stay in touch with your friends during this time? People are finding all kinds of ways to do things. Some kids are talking to their friends on Facebook Live, and some kids are maybe dropping off a gift or something, a toy to a friend, and leaving it on their doorstep and ringing the doorbell or something like that. People are finding all kinds of fun ways of still keeping up with your friends during this time. And those are important things to do. So let me know what you're doing, and I'll keep praying for you, and keep knowing that during this time when we can't be with our friends and our church friends, all of our friends and our neighbors, sometimes we can talk from a distance, sometimes we can talk on the phone, sometimes we can send a card or a letter, a note or a picture. There are all kinds of wonderful things we can do to stay in touch. So I hope you're able to do that with your friends too, so that when you get back together again, you can talk about the good times that you had, getting things ready for each other and getting ready to be back together again. Our love to you, and let's pray now. Dear God, thank you for friendship and for people who look out for each other and who care for each other and do really neat things for each other. Thank you for our church friends and for our church family, the older ones and younger ones and everybody together that loves together and loves our kids. So we thank you and pray that you'll keep us all safe and in love with you. Amen. Our first lesson today comes from the history of the early church in the book of Acts. These are the stories of the beginnings of the church, the very beginnings, when those first Christians were stretching their wings, so to speak, spiritually, and trying to find their place in the world and trying to tell others about the great news that Jesus was alive and living in and through them. So here we go from Acts chapter 2, beginning at verse 36. And this is, again, the end of Peter's sermon, and then it goes on and talks about how these first churches, first Christians lived. Therefore, Peter says, let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him, Jesus, both Lord and Messiah, even this Jesus whom you crucified. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, brothers, what should we do? And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. for the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away. Everyone whom the Lord God, our God, calls to himself. And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved or liberated or freed, the word of the Lord. Now we're going to sing another song about the spirit of the church. This is the church through the ages, including our own age. In unity, we lift our song.
Thank you.
of the Lord from the Gospel according to John, chapter 10, verses 1 through 10, some familiar words about our Good Shepherd. Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate but climbs up by another way is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger. They will run from him because they do not know the voice of the strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." The word of the Lord. There's much in that gospel lesson, but it's the Acts text that I want to focus on in talking with you this morning. You know, one of the best comments that could possibly be made about us is that we are 5G Christians. Now, I don't mean we've got the latest blazing fast smartphones, no. In fact, we might be some of the slowest people around. And that's okay with God. God's rarely in a hurry. God operates on God's time. The late African-American Bishop Cornelius Henderson used to say, "God is not McDonald's. God is crockpot." And then he'd smack his lips. Now, 5G Christians have learned the secrets of this text from the early church. 5G Christians embrace grace, growth, group, gifts, and generosity. So any church, any church folk who have these 5Gs going for them have got something to be glad about. And along the way, we might just slow down enough to really savor the flavors of life. Well, those early Christians knew grace, all right. That grace is getting better than what we deserve, or getting better beyond our dreams. It's being surprised by joy or unexpected goodness in unexpected places in unexpected ways. There are plenty of stories of grace rattling around in the heads of these early church Christians in those days. The story of a selfish son who blows his inheritance and then comes home head hanging. He ought to be pitched out on his ear. Instead, he gets a party that's better than any binge he's ever been on. There are workers who start work at 5 o'clock in the afternoon and get paid for a whole day's work. Whoa, what's that about? And I want to add parenthetically, 3 cheers for all of those businesses who have kept their workers on during this pandemic. That's a tremendous sacrifice, but also a tremendous display of loyalty to their workers. Bless them all. And then there's the story of this poor widow who loses a coin somewhere in her house, turns her house upside down until she finds it, and then spends more than the coin was worth on a party with all of her friends to celebrate finding it. And we're looking forward to celebrations with friends too someday, aren't we? Mm-hmm. Amen. So these people know these stories. Grace means that God does not operate from a balance sheet. God can choose to be generous and lavish and good, better than good, anytime God wants. And these people also know that just a few weeks earlier, some of them denied they even knew Jesus, and the rest of them mostly just ran away and hid. A few of the women hung in there. But here they are, all of them, welcomed and washed by the Spirit, doing their very best to try to out-generous God. Not that they can, they know that. They know where they've been, they know what they've done, but they know also how they failed, and they understand also the stories that Jesus told now. Jesus can give better than what we dream. Grace, both God's grace and our own, is about giving and forgiving way beyond what's expected. In 2002, an organization called Peaceful Tomorrow sent a bunch of Americans to Afghanistan to try to help the civilian victims of U.S. bombing. Remember, this was only a year after 9/11, and there were bombings in Afghanistan and of course, Iraq during that time. And whenever there are bombings, we know that there are always innocent victims. It doesn't matter how targeted those bombings seem to be. There are innocent victims who are killed. Yeah. The military term for that is collateral damage, but it's still death of innocent people. And that was during the time, a year after 9/11, when many Americans believed that you just had to be from the Middle East, or even just look like you were from the Middle East, to be labeled guilty or labeled as part of complicit in the destruction of the Twin Towers. And so the members of Peaceful Tomorrow wanted the United States government to conduct a study of civilian casualties there in Afghanistan and actually provide compensation to the affected families of the innocent. And they knew that there were several times more innocent people killed by that year of U.S. bombs in Afghanistan than actually died in the World Trade Center. So they went to Afghanistan to help, and they went there to meet the survivors face to face. And they said they went to look the survivors in the eyes. And their message, their purpose, they said, was we want to illustrate to the people of Afghanistan and the world that Americans are a caring and generous people. So were they traitors? Were they kooks? Were they doing wrong by our country? Well, that's grace, you see. That's grace. Because every single member of Peaceful Tomorrow who went on that trip was someone who had lost a family member in 9/11. And now we're in a time where anyone from China is in danger of being labeled as complicit in the spreading of this virus around the world. And if you happen to be from the Far East, even look Chinese, things are not good for you these days, and we understand that. And so we have to ask the gracious question, the grace-filled question, what acts of modern-day apostles are going to come through for people to show them that grace is bigger and more than people expect. So with love like that, people who are ready to give, not just generously, but sacrificially, it's no wonder that there in that first century, First Church Jerusalem grew daily. They took care of each other. It's not just a call to see how so-and-so is doing. We call each other, don't we, to check on each other, and that's a great thing. That's a great gift that we're doing these days. I don't mean to belittle phone calls at all. They are very important, especially to people who are not online. But they are an instrument. The phone becomes an instrument of God's grace. But these early Christians did more than that even. Besides staying in touch, they put their money where their mouth was. Nobody in that first church, Jerusalem, had any need. They took care of each other. They sold their stuff so that there'd always be enough for everyone. That's pretty radical stuff, this early Christian faith, isn't it? But we're starting to get the picture. We're seeing a very generous church. We see it today. I think our congregation is a very generous church, and we attempt to live that generosity in every way we possibly can. The question that is going to arise in our time is, how far will we go in following the generosity of Christ, the giving of God? Growth came, and growth and group go together, really, don't they? If you've got this group thing down, this God's group thing, then things are going to happen. Now, I'll admit that calling it group is another G word, and it's kind of lame. I had to kind of sandwich in another G word there, and group, really what it means is we have community. We have common good. We're together in Christ, Christian community in Christ. We'll call it group for just the sake of preaching. But God's group is a group that's loving together, working together, forgiving together, taking care of each other, and also caring for those we don't even want to take care of. That's what marks it as God's group. Because anybody can take care of people you love. God's group calls us to take care of those we don't even think deserve to be taken care of. Well, if we've got this group thing down, then the growth is going to follow. Growth in grace, growth in love, growth in caring, growth in generosity. These early Christians were together in every possible way. They were together in their faith. They were together in their generosity beyond belief. But the real secret of being a group for God, is to be able to look into the eyes of every person that comes through our church doors and see Jesus Christ there. Now that's a challenge these days because we're not going through those church doors and we're not seeing those people and we're not seeing each other. So we can't look into each other's eyes. But that's a great promise. And those days will come again when we can be a group together and look into each other's eyes. And when we're together, like those early Christians were, we also all have gifts to share. I remember when I was a campus minister, one of our students, her name was Abigail, had the purest singing voice I have ever heard in my life. She had a sweet smile, and when she sang, her face would just glow. And Abigail went on to marry a clergy person, actually, and she is a concert singer, but hardly famous outside of the New York area. But it doesn't matter, because she's always singing for God and singing for the sheer joy of it. And you can see it on her face. That's her gift that she shares. I'm remembering Jim. You're all remembering people, too. People who have contributed to the life of this congregation. Jim, well, he wasn't a singer. I don't know if he could even eke out a tune. Who could tell? Because Jim never sang loud enough for most of us to know. But Jim was an usher. And he hugged people when they came to church if he thought they needed a hug. And he was also a little bit famous for his bean soup. And when Jim was dying of cancer and in pain, he didn't ever talk about the pain. He talked about missing the people he used to hug. He talked about not being able to make bean soup anymore. Friends, when we get back together, right now we're missing hugs, and even when we get back together, we're probably not going to be hugging each other like we used to. That's going to be the new normal for us, and we're going to miss that. But when we get back together, maybe we can instead learn to look into each other's eyes and smile and know each other that way. There's a children's song that goes, "Everyone's got a place in the choir." And that's what it's about, isn't it? It's not about music, though. It's about something bigger than that. It's about early Christians gathered together, taking care of each other, reaching out to each other, worshiping together, growing together, eating together, loving together. And we're going to look forward to together. And we're still together in spirit. We're looking together. I know a lot of you women are looking forward to being together in the sisters group. You're still together, calling each other, talking to each other. I know we're looking forward together to some of those dinners that we have, whether it's a community dinner downstairs or some of Verdell and her crew cooking for us, providing us these unforgettable dinners. And we might even be looking forward to another year of a rummage sale, because in the rummage sale, people shoulder to shoulder work together and get things done. But we also welcome in the community, and people can get things that they couldn't afford otherwise. So there are different ways for us to be together, and there are ways that we look forward to being together again. For now, though, this whole passage is summed up in a tiny phrase in the next to the last verse that says, they did it all with glad and generous hearts. With glad and generous hearts. There they are, more G's, glad and generous. Can it get any better than that in a church, in your church, in our church? With glad and generous hearts. No virus can stop glad and generous hearts. No mask can hide glad and generous hearts. No stay-at-home order can shut down glad and generous hearts. Get gripped by that. Glory to our good and gracious God. There are five G's there, maybe more. Just savor it. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. We're so grateful in times like this when we remember the words of the psalmist, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me, they guide me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies." Because eating together means we can no longer be enemies. "Thou anointest my head with the oil of gladness. My cup runneth over. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And so, Good Shepherd, you've called us to be one with each other and one in you. We know your voice. We follow you. We do what you would lead us to do. Help us to hear your voice and to obey and be with those who are seemingly ignoring your voice in these days. Soften hardened hearts. Change stony minds. Guide in the ways that lead to life and life more abundantly. Oh God, how we need you these days, and how we need each other. So show us new ways to be together in you. Keep alive in us the hope for the future, that even though we are one in our distance, we will also again be one together in you. Indeed, we already are. Remind us of that great truth. And Jesus, along the road, along this way, as we seek to be filled with your Spirit, fill us with your presence, even as we pray with you today. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The closing hymn is simply a chorus. Bind us together, Lord. Bind us together in love. Receive now the blessing wherever you are. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the never-ending love of God, who calls us, created us, comforts us, and the presence and peace and power of God's Spirit be present with us now in our times of need and in our times of joy, in our celebrations and in our sorrows. Wrapped in the love of God and the togetherness we have in Christ. So be it. Amen. Let me remind you before we go today that next Sunday is the Festival of the Christian Home. We call it Mother's Day, colloquially. And we will celebrate Holy Communion virtually in celebration of our families, in celebration of all kinds of families, as we come together around the table virtually and prepare ourselves to eat and drink the heavenly feast. I'll see you next week. God bless. Keep praying. Amen.